Amen. Before I get started, I would like to acknowledge, recognize our man and woman of God. Can we give God some praise for Apostles Tony and Cynthia Brazelton? Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. We're going to learn something today about honor and why it is that people stood up when I mentioned their names. We'll learn a little bit more about that later. I also want to acknowledge my wife who's over in Children's Church. And let's give God some praise for my wife. Now, the reason why I mention my wife is really not for you guys, it's for me. Because once I mention my wife, then I feel like preaching. Amen. But we ought to definitely thank God for one another. I'm just so thankful that I get to do life with my beautiful wife. I get to do life with her. She gets to do life with me. I know that we live in a world where there are Christian marriages that are failing at the same rate as the world, as ungodly marriages, and that should just not be. I mean, if we're submitted unto the Lord, we're submitted to one another, then we should be an example of heaven on earth as a man and a woman of God. So we should thank one another, be thankful for one another, and build each other up, never tear each other down, allow no corrupt communication to proceed from out of our mouths, but only that which is good to the use of edifying, and we should continually on a daily basis minister grace to one another. Amen? Amen. So the reason why I mentioned our apostles, well, first of all, they're our leaders and we operate under their covering. But really, as I was meditating over what to share with you, the Lord showed me them and then showed me what he wanted me to say. And so my assignment this morning is to minister a message entitled, You Must Be Able to See It. The message is entitled, You Must, say must. Be able to see it. You must be able to see in the spirit. You must. It is critical as a believer, as a born-again believer, you must be able to see in the spirit. If you can't see, then you can't see. You don't know how to live. You must be able to see what God has called you to do. You must be able to see what God has already prepared for you. You must be able to see what is already yours. Say amen to that. Amen. As a believer, we're called, Elder Georgia, not necessarily to live by what we learn. We're actually called to live by what we can discern. And so as a believer, we are supposed to, what we discern should be greater to us than what we learn. Revelation is much greater, is on a greater level than education. And so revelation comes, and God can give us things via revelation that exceed anything that we could receive from the realm of this world by way of information. So God calls us to live by what we are able to see. It's hard, and this is critical, because it's hard for any person, especially a believer, to receive what you cannot perceive. And so what God wants is for you to have a level of spiritual perception, because you're born again. Once you're born again, everything is supposed to change. And we're going to look at that in Scripture. Once you're born again, you're born from above. God never intended for your post-conversion life to equal your pre-conversion life. If nothing changed, then you have to question whether or not something changed. I mean, when you're born again, you're not supposed to live like you were living before. You are a spiritual being. You're born from above. You're born again. You're filled with God's Spirit, covered by the blood, anointed by the Spirit, called according to God's work and purpose for your life. Everything has been made new. You're supposed to live by a different reality. Say amen to that. Amen. From the time you're born again, you are supposed to die, yield, decrease, so that God can flow through you and so that you can become the man, the woman that God called and destined and designed and desires for you to be. God made plans for you from the foundations of the world. Therefore, success for you cannot be measured in money or in cars or in clothes. Success for you can only be measured in divine purpose. And so to the extent that you die to self, to the extent that you find and follow and finish your purpose, to the extent that you discover and develop in and then deploy into your purpose, to the extent that you become the man and woman that God has called you to be, that's the level of success that you will experience. So success for you is all about your divine assignment. That's why you cannot spend time worrying about other people. You can't compare yourself to other people. You cannot spend time. You cannot have competitive jealousy in the body of Christ. You should be able to to celebrate one another, because I'm not called to be you and you're not called to be me. I can't be you and you can't be me. So I don't need to sweat you. In the country, they say, I don't need to stunt you. I'm not even worried about you. I'm assigned to be me. I will pray for you. I will intercede for you. I will stand in the gap for you. I'm here to be your cheerleader. When you get yours, I celebrate with you, because it's only a matter of time before I get mine. But I must be able to see it. Listen, if you can't see it, you can't have it. That's how God set it up. God set it up. God made plans for you from the foundations of the world, and he has set it up for you to live your life from the inside out. There must be an outworking of the internal. There must be an outpouring of the internal. You're supposed to live your life spirit-led. You're supposed to live your life from inside, not from the outside. That's why we learned today that when we relate to people, we're not even supposed to relate to people from a worldly perspective or from a worldly point of view. We're not even supposed to relate to people from the outside. We're supposed to relate to people from the inside. We're supposed to be able to discern who they are. That's why when I said apostles Tony and Cynthia Brazelton, people stood up. You know why people stood up? Because they understand Hebrews 13:7. Hebrews 13:7 says that we ought to consider those who God assigned to bring us the word of God. We ought to honor those who God assigned to bring us the word of God. The Bible says that we should consider the outcome of their well-spent lives and then imitate their faith. We're not called to imitate what they drive. We're not called to imitate what they wear. We're not called to imitate how they look. We are called to imitate the faith they used to get to where they are. But in order to do that, you must have a man and a woman of God who are able, who are willing to expose themselves to you, who are willing to tell you, to show you, to reveal to you what they did to get to where they are. And what they did is hear from God. We have a man and a woman of God who hear from God. We have a man and a woman of God who are not moved by what they see in the natural. They are only moved by what they see in the spirit, and they are not moved. As a matter of fact, things can get worse before they get better, and they are not moved, because they're not living contingent upon the things of this world. As a matter of fact, I've seen it. I've been here now, 6 years? I've seen it. If you try to put pressure on Pastor Tony to make a decision, if you try to put pressure, hey, Dad, listen, we're running out of time. Hey, listen, I need it by this day. I need it, hey, at that point, matter of fact, it's like he just go, like he'll ignore you even more, because he's not living off of this reality. If God doesn't speak, then he doesn't speak. If God doesn't say it, he doesn't have anything to say. And that's how we're supposed to live. If you got to be able to see it. Now, the reason why I'm bringing them up, because Apostles Tony and Cynthia Brazelton are modeling for us what success looks like. They are modeling for us corporately. So what they do here at the church, corporately, we're supposed to do individually. Say this. Say, I am the pastor of my own home. So just like we get vision here and they communicate and they cast vision here, you're supposed to be casting vision at home. Just like we get kingdom projects here, you're supposed to be getting kingdom projects at home. Just like we got to believe God for finances here, you're supposed to be able to believe God for finances at home. You're supposed to live just like they're living here. You're supposed to be living that way at home. You're supposed to be living from the inside out, living off of a different reality. Not moved by what you see. You're not moved. You cannot allow what you see in the natural to change what you said in the spirit. You cannot be moved. And so like Pastor Tony, he's not moved. He said, the Lord said, that's our building. I mean, all, you know, it's like the three Hebrew boys. The enemy came and said, let me crank up the heat 5 times hotter. You know what I'm saying? I mean, like, it's like once you communicate, once you declare a thing, it's like the enemy will crank up the heat on you. He's trying to get you to change what you said. At no point did Pastor Tony change what he said. Why? Because he saw it. And the things that we can see in the spirit are more real, supposed to be more real to us than what we see down here in this realm. And I told you before that when you live in sync with heaven, it might mean that you live out of sync with the people down here in this world. And that has to be okay with you. that has to be okay. It has to be okay. It has to be okay with you to look crazy. Because if you're going to be led of the Spirit, God will get you out there at the risk of looking foolish. You cannot live by faith if you have, if you're afraid of looking crazy. To live by faith, God will get you out there so far, you will have to say things that sound crazy to people. I remember when I first got here, and the Lord showed me, the Lord had a woman to prophesy our house that we have now here in Woodbridge. God had a woman to prophesy that house to me in a dining facility in Iraq. I was a pastor of the gospel service. And she drew my house, like the front of my house, on a napkin. And I had that napkin. And then the Lord spoke a word to me. And he said, you're going to have a $1 million house and not pay $1 million for it. And so I received it, and I have a napkin and I have a word. But then I got a real estate agent who's not born again. I got a napkin and I got a word, Shawana. But I got a real estate agent who's living by this reality. So he's trying to show me stuff. Well, you pre-qualified, blah, blah, blah. The VA, max VA loan is $720,000. I'm going to show you this. I'm going to show you that. We're looking at houses in Lord. I spent a whole Saturday looking at stuff I knew wasn't mine. Then I was like, man, how am I going to do this thing? Then the next Saturday, we did it again. And he's showing me all these houses that he thinks I can afford. And I'm like, well, that's not what God said. And so I got Isabella in Seattle looking at all these homes, like big old homes. And I'm like, well, and she's like, go look at this one. And I'm like, how am I supposed to tell this man that I'm supposed to go? How am I, Lord, how I'm? I said, forget it. I'm just going to, whatever. God said it. So that I wasted two Saturdays. The third Saturday, I was right there in his office in Stafford. I walked in. He said, hey, Rick, I got all these houses. I said, forget it. I ain't looking at none of those houses. I said, look, this is what I got. I got a napkin and I got a word. I'm telling you, you must be able to see it. And that's how we got the house we got now. He said, I never heard nothing like this, but I guess what? I'm excited. Let's see what happens. And it was a testimony. Last weekend, I was in the Dominican Republic. And so the Lord showed me a piece of land. And so we have these two schools. We're providing education for 122 children. And right now, we're paying rent in two places. And so the Lord, the Lord moved on our heart and said, well, you're going to get them some land, build a school, you're going to build them a church, gave us the name of the school, name of the church, everything. Got all that. And then I saw an image of the land. I could see what it looks like. And so then, same thing, same situation, right? So this real estate agent comes on a motorcycle. That was, so Isabella was up in this apartment that the Lord gave us. So she's up there in the apartment, and I jump on the back of this motorcycle, and we go looking for land. And so we're looking at the land. We drive up, and I'm like, this ain't it. Now, this guy's born again, so I could try to, but still, how even people that are born again would try to get you in the natural, And so I'm like, I said, no, this ain't it. But we haven't even seen the land. I said, I can tell you from here. It ain't it, right? I mean, this is not what I saw. Oh, you're like, oh, Brother Pena, this is crazy. You're like, okay, Brother Pena, give me some Bible on that. Fine, I'll give it to you. You don't have to turn there. I'm going to quote it for you. Ecclesiastes chapter 3 and 15, write that down. Ecclesiastes chapter 3 and verse 15, and I want you to read that from the Amplified. You know what the Amplified says? It says that which is has already been. Watch this. That which is right now, say everything I can see right now has already been. Now, it's hard enough to wrap your mind around that, right? Natural mind. But if that were not hard enough, what Solomon says next really kind of messes with people real bad if you're not born again. He says now, and that which is, that which will be has already been. Now, that which is has already been, you could come almost kind of get to that, but that which will be has already been. And then the Amplified says, God seeks that which has passed by so that history repeats itself. What is happening? God, when God looks at you, God already made plans for you, Brother Brave Boy. God made plans for you from the foundations of the world. God planned out your whole life from the time you were born to the time you die. He rewound the tape and then pressed play. So now when he's looking at you, all he's looking for is what he planned. He's looking for history to repeat itself. So when we were driving around looking for the land, I'm looking for history to repeat itself. God already showed me the land. So when we would go up and say, that ain't it. And so we get out the car, and then I went out with some other real estate agents that definitely were not born again, and they were trying to get over on me because I'm American, right? So they're trying to show me all this stuff, and I'm like, nah, this ain't it. And no, hold on, but let me tell you why. I said, you don't have to waste your time. I can look at it and tell you this ain't it. This is not what I saw. And they're like, not what you saw. Cuckoo, cuckoo, right? We're supposed to live off of a different reality. This is how our man and woman of God live. They live, listen, God has already given you all things. God has already. I mean, Ephesians 1 and 3 says that God has, past tense, blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. God has already done this. Ephesians 2 and 10 says that we are his workmanship created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which he has before ordained that we should walk therein. It's already done. Say it's already done. So what does this mean? The same way Pastor Tony, Pastor Cynthia, they release and cast vision for the corporate body, you're supposed to be believing for your own self, for your own house. So the same way. So just like, watch this, God has already made plans for your business. Amen. The resources you need for your business already stored up. Yeah. Education, you say, I believe the Lord told me to go to this school, but how am I going to pay for it? He didn't ask you to pay for it. Amen. He asked you to believe for it. If he revealed it to you that you're supposed to go to that school, then the bill is his. God has a million ways to get you $1 million. I mean, God don't have no issue with money. God, the issue is you lining up with your divine assignment. So whatever it is for your business, for your career, for your school, whatever, your education, you have to be able to see it. Because if you can't see it, you can't have it. Say amen to that. Amen. All right, so let's look at 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Let's go there. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, you have to be able to see. We are called to live from a spiritual perspective. No longer are we supposed to relate to anyone or see anything from a worldly point of view, from a carnal point of view. Now, say this. Say, I am naturally supernatural. See, once you're born again, then you're naturally supernatural. Miracles, signs, and wonders are normal for us. Amen. I mean, it's not supposed to be like some weird thing. It's normal for us, right? So in the Dominican Republic last weekend when I was there, I got there and the architect that was doing our apartment, I got there and I needed to talk to him. But before I could talk to him, he was really frustrated. He was yelling at somebody on the phone. And when he got off the phone, he was like, oh man, I'm sorry. I got all this pressure on me and I got a pounding headache or whatever. And I was like, okay, cool. But before we talk, Kent, do you mind if I pray for you? And you know how people are like, hey, yeah, you can pray for me. You know, I mean, they really don't expect nothing to happen, right? So I prayed for him, you know, rebuked the headache, and that was it. And so I said, well, we'll talk. And I left alone. And so the next morning, he was like, man, the headache went away. I was like, well, you didn't expect that? I mean, you didn't expect the headache to go away? And so that opened up an opportunity for me to minister to him. And when I told him that God made plans for him, Isabella's not here, but Isabella was standing right next to me, and I told him that God made plans for him from the foundations of the world. Man, he had never heard that before. I'm talking about this is somebody been in church all their life, but never heard that before. And his eyes got like this big. He stepped back. He said, really? For me? I said, come on, man. You're an architect, right? I said, you have to make plans for all these buildings. I said, watch this. Nobody on this site and on the next site, because they're already working on the next site, I said, none of these construction workers can lay one cement block down until you finish the plans. True or false? He said, true. I said, you have to finish the plans and then get the plans approved before they can ever get started. True or false? He said, true. I said, guess what? God finished you before you ever got started. I said, how do you think that all of this stuff can be built and can't be built until you finish the plans? How do you think God was going to let you be born with no plans? You're not going to let no building go up with no plans. God, before you ever took one breath on this planet, God made plans. Before you ever took one step on this planet, God made plans. Say, I am not a mistake. Say, I was born for a reason. And that reason is my divine assignment. So you're here for a divine assignment, for a divine purpose. Nobody else has your DNA. Nobody else has your voice print. Nobody else has your fingerprint. Nobody else has your divine assignment. Only you can be you, so you might as well be you. You might as well maximize you. You have the grace to be you. Nobody else has the grace for your race. So you ought to run with patience the race that is set before you. Are we there? 2 Corinthians chapter 5. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. I'm going to read for you verses 14 through 17. I'm going to read it from the easy to read version because I'm from Brooklyn and this is easy to read, right? So the Apostle Paul said, the love of Christ controls us. Because we know that one person died for everyone, so all have died. He died for all so that those who would live would not continue to live for themselves. He died for them and was raised from death so that they would live for him. From this time on, we don't think of anyone the way the world thinks of people. It is true, though, that in the past we thought of Christ that way. But we don't think that way now when anyone is in Christ. It's a whole new world. Old things are gone. Suddenly, everything is new. I want to get to the point where it says we don't think that way now. But before we do that, let me just mention a little bit of the beginning of it, right? So the Apostle Paul says the love of Christ controls us because we know that one person died for everyone. That one person was Jesus. And now watch this. Now Jesus was perfect. So if he was perfect, he was the only innocent man to ever walk the planet. He was the only sinless man to ever walk the planet. He was completely perfect, so he did not have to die, but he died. And that one person died for everyone. That means that he did not die his death. He died my death. He died your death. He died for you because you're the one that was guilty. He paid a debt that you could not pay. He paid a price that he did not owe for a debt that you could not pay. And so he did it for you. He did it for us. Now, because of that, because he didn't die his death, he died our death. The Bible says, so all have died. Say, I'm in Christ. Therefore, I'm dead. So listen, I mean, you are dead now. I've done all the dying I'm going to do. For me, when I die, I don't die. I mean, it's like when I take off this jacket, it just falls to the ground. When I take off this earth suit, it's just going to fall to the ground. For me, dying is not dying. I did all the dying I'm going to do. I'm dead in Christ. For me, the day I die is just moving day. I don't die, I just get to move from earth to glory, from time to eternity, from mortal to immortality. So there's nothing to say, nothing to be upset about when a born-again believer dies. Said, we didn't lose them. Oh, we lost such and such. You didn't lose them. When you lose something, you don't know where it is. If they're born again, we know where they are. They ain't lost, they're gone, they moved. Let's celebrate. Glory to God. The Bible says you died. Jesus died for all, so all have died. The Bible says he died for all so that those who would live would not continue to live for themselves. Oh, did he say that? He died for you so that you could not continue to be selfish. So this, I'm talking about living off of a different reality, right? So in the world, we say the opposite of love is what? That's what the world says. But in the kingdom, the opposite of love is not hate. The opposite of love is selfishness. Because when you understand love, you're living for others. You're living for God. Before you're born again, before you get to know love, you're living for yourself. Just like in the world, we say the opposite of faith is what? Some people say fear. Some people say doubt. But in the kingdom, the opposite of faith is sight. That's why 2 Corinthians 5 and 7 says we walk by what? And not by what? The opposite of faith is sight. Because what happens is people that are not living by faith, they live by what they can see in this world. Natural eyes, what they can see in this world. People that live by faith are living by what they can see. Different reality. So they are living by what they perceive. They are living by what they see in the spirit. They are living by what they receive from God. That you have to be able to see it. If you can't see it, you can't live by faith. You don't even know what to pray. You don't even know what to believe God for. You don't even know what to sow. You don't even know what to say. You don't know anything if you can't see it. Jesus said, I only say those things I hear my Father say. I only do those things I see my Father do. I'm not here for myself. He said, the Son can do nothing without the Father. I'm not here, Jesus said, to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. So you're born again, Jesus said. He died for you so that you could not continue to live for yourself. You were selfish before you were born again. And the day you're born again, you're supposed to start living selfless. It's not about you no more. Amen. As a born-again believer, it's not about you no more. The life that you live, it is in him that we live and move and have our being. The life that you live now, you're supposed to live for Christ. It's all about Jesus. Say amen to that. Amen. He says he died for them so that those who live would not continue to live for themselves. He died for them and was raised from death so that they would live for him. You have to be able to live for him. Your goal should be to live for him. Paul said, for me, to live is Christ. I love Paul's attitude. Okay, fine, fine, Paul, fine. You want to go there? I'm going to kill you. That's cool, too. He said, for me, to die is gain. He messed them all up. He was like, all right, okay, hold on. Let me think about that. Live Christ. Die gain. Okay, fine, Paul. You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to make you suffer. He said, that's cool, too. For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory that shall be revealed in us. Paul's attitude was, if you let me live, I'll serve the Lord. If you kill me, I'll go on to glory. If you make me suffer, I have a bigger crown when I get there. But there's nothing you can do to make me stop. I live for Christ. But you got to be able to see it. And then Paul said this, from this time on, we don't think of anyone as the way the world thinks of people. We're not relating to anyone that way. Let me give you that same line from some other translations. The Amplified reads, so from now on, we regard no one from a human point of view, according to worldly standards. The J.B. Phillips reads, this means that our knowledge of man can no longer be based on their outward lives. The Contemporary English Version reads, we are careful not to judge people by what they seem to be. And finally, the Message Bible reads, because of this decision, we don't evaluate people by what they have or how they look. We're not basing people in the world. That's what the world does. That's why all these people have all these Instagram followers. Why? Because they're enamored by their earth suit. They're enamored by what they have. They're looking at what they have on or what they don't have on. And so they're looking at that, and they're enamored. They only know people by a worldly point of view. And so they're relating to people by how they look, or they're relating to people by what they have, but they are not relating to people by who they are. That's not who they are. If you're born again, you're not supposed to relate to anyone like that anymore. You're supposed to relate to people by who God called them to be. You're supposed to be able to perceive who they are. You're supposed to be able to perceive who they are in the spirit. You got to be able to perceive. That's why, somebody can walk in. Let's say somebody can walk in here that we don't know them. They're a visitor. They just walk in, and a lot of times an usher who's hearing from God will be able to perceive who they are. And be able to just see who they are. Has anyone ever encountered someone that just walks up to you and calls you by your assignment? Happens to me all the time. People that don't even know me, they come and they identify me by my assignment without me saying anything. You know why? Because that is spiritual perception. And that's how we're supposed to live. We're not supposed to relate to anyone the way the world relates to people. See, when God thinks of people, he doesn't think of people the way that we think of people. Three things I'm going to talk about today as it relates to this. The way you see others, the way you see yourself, and the way you see your purpose. The way you see others, the way you see yourself, the way you see your purpose. Let me deal with the way you see others. Before I do, let me just talk about Adam for a minute because I mentioned him, right? So Adam, think about Adam. Because when Jesus died, he died to redeem us. Not back to Abraham. Jesus died to redeem us all the way back to Adam, right? So if you look at Adam in Genesis chapter 2, think about Adam. He never went to school. So where did he come up with the names? The names of the animals. The names of the animals were not learned. They were discerned, right? He just looked at them and said, giraffe, right? He just looked at them and said, lion. He looked at them and said, bear. I wish he would have looked at it and said, mosquito. Right. But it was not learned. It was discerned. He discerned, right? He was living off of a different reality. He was walking with God. God was walking with him. He was walking with God in the cool of the day. And the Bible says in Genesis 2 and 25 that the man and his wife were so in the spirit, were so connected to God in the spirit, that the man and his wife were naked and they were not ashamed because they were not even cognizant of the fact that they were naked. They were so spirit-led that it never even registered to them that they had no natural clothes on. Now, they were clothed with the glory of God, but they had no natural clothes on, and it never even occurred to them that they had no natural clothes on because they were so connected to God in the spirit, and that's how we're supposed to live. Jesus came to redeem us all the way back to that, to where you can receive things by revelation that far exceed anything you could have ever received by education. I'm not saying that education is bad. I have an education, so does my wife, and my kids will have an education, glory to God. So I'm not saying having an education is bad, but you can never put education above revelation. You have to be able to live by what you perceive. You have to be able to live by what you can see in the spirit. We are called to live by a different reality. Why? Because God already made plans. And so we are called to be able to peer into the realm of, we're called to do this. We say, I live
right now
on the earth. But watch this. God has called that when he said, when you pray this, thy will be done where? How? How are you going to pray heaven, will on earth if you can't see it? So you're called to live in the earth, but you're called to peer into heaven. And when I get to peer into heaven from the earth, I'm supposed to come back from that reality and say what I saw. I'm supposed to come back from that encounter and walk out what I experienced. So say this. Say, I am right now
in the
continuum of time. But God is in eternity. And so for God's plans for me already done in eternity, but I'm here in the continuum of time. So what God does in prayer is that in prayer, I'm able to see into eternity from time. I'm able to peer into eternity from time. I'm able to see things that may not happen for 5, 10, 15, 20 years, but I see it now in time, and I'm seeing it from eternity. And when God speaks to me today in time, he's speaking to me from eternity. So when he speaks to me, money, he's speaking to me from the position of the eternal now. He's outside of time. So when he speaks to me like it's already done now in time. Even though for me, it might be 5 years, 10 years, 15 years. But for me, when he speaks to me, he says like it's already done. So I have to come back out of that moment, out of that experience, out of that vision. I have to come back into time and live out what I saw. Faith is living in time based on what I can see in eternity. Faith is living in the earth based on what I can see in heaven. But faith is living based on a different reality. And then, so convinced that I'm not even moved by what I see down here. So convinced that if it gets worse before it gets better. So convinced that if I get a doctor's report that's telling me something else, I already got a report before I got that doctor's report. Then I'm posed with the question. The psalmist said, now you got two reports. Whose report shall we believe? We shall believe the report of the Lord. Say amen to that. So, you can't see others in the flesh. You are called to see others in the spirit. When God looks at people, when God looks at a man or woman, he sees two things. Number one, he sees the plans that he made for them from the foundations of the world, right? So when God looks at you, Darren, God is looking at you. He sees all the plans. He sees the whole span of your life. That's why God is not tripping off of what you just did if you made a mistake. God is not tripping. That's why John said in 1 John, he said that when our heart condemns us, God is greater than our heart because he knows all things. So he's like, man, he's tripping off of what he did on Tuesday, and I'm looking at the whole span of his life. So I'm looking at your whole life, and here you are concerned about that. Dude, I'm bigger than that. Jesus died for that. When I called you, I knew you wasn't going to be perfect, but Jesus was perfect for you. And so when I'm looking at you, he's looking at you, he sees everything, the whole span of your life, that's number one. And then number two, he sees how submitted you are because he's looking at your heart. He sees how submitted you are to that assignment. How either submitted or not submitted you are to that divine assignment. That's how God sees. Remember when God had to deal with the prophet Samuel? Hey, you have Samuel who's a man of God who could see in the spirit. He was a seer. God spoke to him, all kind of things. And God says to Samuel, go down to Jesse's house because I've anointed one of his sons. I've called one of his sons to be the next king. And he was like, no, come on, man, Saul. He's a good king. He's like, listen, it's done. I didn't ask you. This ain't no debate. It's over, you know. Go down to Jesse's house. And so he goes to Jesse's house, and he goes up to Jesse and says, hey, listen, the Lord sent me here, and I need you to, one of your sons is going to be the next king. And so Jesse lines up his boys and says, so, you know, David didn't have not even one friend in the house. You know what I'm saying? I mean, it's not as bad enough that his daddy didn't say, hey, hold on, I have one more son. But nobody. I mean, did somebody play tag with David? My God. I mean, somebody could have said, one of his brothers could have said, hold on, daddy. I know he ain't going to get picked, but let's at least have him in the lineup or something, you know. But But they line them up, and so the man of God, who hears from God, stands before the first one, and he says, surely this is the one. You know why? Because he got enamored by his earth suit. He said, because he looked good on the outside. And the Lord says to Samuel, listen, son, have you hear all this stuff from me? You can't hear this? You know that I don't work like that. Men get enamored by earth suits. But I don't look at the outside. I'm looking at the condition of your heart. So he, when he looks at you, he sees the whole span of your life. And then he also sees where you are as it relates to that assignment. He sees how submitted you are or how committed you are to that assignment. And he relates to you accordingly. Say amen to that.
Amen.
So when we got to see people. The outer man is not the real person. We have to relate to people how God relates to people. That's why it takes honor to really relate to people. When I said, let's thank God for apostles, Tony and Cynthia Brazelton. A lot of people stood up. You know why? Because we know them. Not the outer man. We know them. It takes honor to relate to people for who they really are. It takes, that's why, watch this. The currency of the kingdom of God. Say, I am
a kingdom citizen.
Right now. So
right now,
you are a kingdom citizen. Right now, if you're born again, let me tell you what happened when you were born again, if you're born again. So if you're born again, you're already filled with the Spirit of God, right? The Bible says that you're sealed with the Spirit. Once you believe, you're sealed with the Spirit until the day of redemption. That's Ephesians 1 and 13. So you're sealed with the Spirit. Not only that, the Bible says that you are ascended into heaven and seated at the right hand of the Father with Christ Jesus. So right now, you are seated at 14747 Arizona Avenue. And at the same time, you are seated in heavenly places with Christ Jesus. Right now. Say right now. The Bible also says that you were, past tense, translated from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of God's dear Son. You already, past tense, already happened. So God has already moved you, ascended you, seated you, filled you, covered you, called you, already done. But now you have to live off of that reality for yourself, and you have to live off of that reality for others. That's why. So faith is the currency of the kingdom. There, you can't make an exchange in the kingdom of God without faith. But while faith is the currency, honor is the culture. So the culture of the kingdom of God is this culture of honor. Say honor. What is honor? Honor is when God looks at you, he's not tripping off of what you did. So honor is that same thing. I'm able to look at you and perceive. I'm able to look at you and perceive who God called you to be. And honor, when I honor you, I'm able to honor the divine assignment on your life, and I'm not tripping off your humanity. I'm not tripping off of what you did to me in the past. I'm not tripping off the mistakes that you made. I don't allow your humanity to keep me from honoring your divinity. So we don't know anyone from a worldly point of view. We're supposed to perceive people in the spirit. And so when I perceive, watch this, because if you can't see someone in the spirit, you can't receive from them in the spirit. That's why it's healthy for you to be around people whose anointing on their lives makes you feel inadequate. It's healthy. Now, I don't mean inadequate like low self-esteem, but I mean inadequate like, my God, they're anointed. You know what I'm saying? I remember the first time I came here, I think I was seated right there, and Pastor Cynthia was right here. And I had heard Pastor Cynthia at World Changes several times. And so, but you know, World Changes is big, right? So, I wasn't that close. And I was like right there, and she was like right there, and I was like, my God. I'm like 6 feet away. Pastor Cynthia, why not? And so she was preaching. And I remember the first time we were downstairs, and I said something to her, and I was like, hey, Mom, you know, blah, blah, blah. I was talking about the jail ministry or something. And she said, okay, well, pray for me. I was talking about how to pray for somebody in jail ministry, Shawana. And I said, and she said, okay, well, pray for me. I said, what? She said, no, pray for me. Something happened with my eye, and I need you to pray for me. She put her hands out like this. And I felt like, I'm just being honest, right, being transparent. I was like, how can I pray for you? I'm like, you know, like John the Baptist, you know, oh, I can't baptize you. Oh, Lord, how can I baptize? I was like, me pray for you? Oh, Jesus. And so, Isabella might get over it, but I'm going to say this anyway. Isabella, when they were in Mexico, she said that Mom laid her head on, they were in a van or something, and Mom fell asleep on her shoulder. And Isabella said, man, I wouldn't move. My back could be killing me. I wasn't going to move. My God. She's like, Mom is sleeping on me. I ain't gonna move. I love you, babe. So what am I saying, though? It's healthy to be around people who you can perceive that the anointing on their life is so great that it causes you to go back and fall on your face and get before the Lord. I've heard dad say stuff. I've seen mom do things, and it causes me to leave here and go back home and say, woe is me. Isaiah, in Isaiah 6, was in an encounter with God, and he was there, and there were angels crying out, holy, and another angel was crying out, holy back. And as he's in this place, in this moment, the proper response to the presence of the Lord is worship. He fell down on his face. He says, woe is me. I'm a man of unclean lips. I'm amongst people who are unclean. My God, you need to be around somebody who, when you get in their presence, you're like, I need to pray more. I need to study more. I need to pursue God more. And we don't do that because of what they look like in the flesh. We do that because we perceive who they are in the spirit. Say, I must be able to see it. You got to be able to see somebody for who they really are. You got to be able to relate to people for who God called them to be. You got to be able to build people up and not tear people down. When you look at your children, you need to see your children for who God called them to be and speak life over them. Watch this. Not only should you do, you got to be able to see people. Why? Because there's more to people than meets the eye. There's more to people. You got to relate to them the way that God would relate to them. You got to relate to them because you are only, listen, if you see your pastor as just a man, you will never be able to receive from the God in the man. So what we do is not man worship. What we do is called honor. So we honor a man of God. We honor a woman of God. Why? Because we want to protect the anointing that's on their lives. We want to protect ourselves. Watch this. Even the PPAs, we have to be careful. You don't want to get so close to the man or woman of God that you fail to honor the anointing that's on their lives. Because if you ever get to the point where you see them as a mere man, now you've gotten out of the spirit, you've gotten into the flesh. And you cannot receive from those you do not honor. Say, I must be able to see it. So seeing others in the spirit is good. Watch this, but here's a real key point. You got to see yourself in the spirit. You got to be able to honor the same way you are supposed to be honor the man and woman of God, honor the anointing on people's lives, honor the anointing on your children, honor the anointing on everybody. You're supposed to be able to honor them. The same way you got to be able to look in the mirror and honor yourself. You got to be able to see yourself. You don't even look at yourself from a worldly point of view. You got to be able to look at yourself and see, I am who God called me to be. I am who God says I am. I can do what God said I can do. I will be who God called me to be. I'm not moved by, listen, even this, watch this. Let me help somebody out who's struggling with sin or struggling with a mistake that you keep making over and over again. You got to be able to, right after you make that mistake, you got to be able to look in the mirror and say, I am the righteousness of God in Christ. Say, I am righteous right now, not because of what I do, not because of what I failed to do. Say, I am only righteous because of what Jesus did. Give God some praise for that. You got to be able to die to your limitations, die to yourself. Watch this. When God is showing you things about his divine assignment for your life, this is where we try. A lot of times, we inject our humanity where God is only calculating divinity. And so we mess around, and we could put a no where God put a yes. Why? Because we try to factor in. We say, well, how can I do that? I don't have the education. I don't have the money. I don't have this in my bank account. God didn't ask you for all that. God says, this is who you are. And wait, watch this. When you die to yourself, you even have to get to the point where you die to your limits. When you get to the point where you die to your limits, you're like, okay, God, whatever you say, I'm good with it. Whatever you say. Listen, whatever. I don't care. Whatever you say. When the Lord told me, go look for this land, we started looking for the land. I thought I knew what, you know, what the price was going to be or whatever. The Lord didn't tell me the price. He just showed me the land. And so we go and we start looking at prices, and the price was more than I expected. So what? Right? I mean, God didn't tell me to worry about the price. He told me to look at the land. Right? So what? I mean, God can give you $20,000 the same way he can give you $200,000 the same way he can give you $20 million. I mean, not, what is big to God? I remember when I first got the house that we live in here, one of my family members, his wife, said, I told him, the Lord wants us to have this house. The Lord gave us this house. And she said to her husband, why would God want you to have a house that big? And I asked her, what's big to God? I mean, like, how big does your house have to be for God to say, whoa, right? I mean, that's crazy, because what's happened is you're thinking off of this reality. You're not thinking like God. You're thinking like yourself. That's why Paul said, from this time on, we don't see anyone the way the world sees people. And then he says, now in the past, though, we thought of Christ that way, but we don't think that way now. You're born again. You're supposed to think differently, see differently, live differently. Everything is different. Everything is made new. Everything changed. Say amen to that. Once God reveals his plan for your life, then your part is simply to accept it, to believe it, to receive it, and to pursue it by faith. God made the plans by grace. You pursue it by faith, and he didn't ask you to figure it out. He didn't ask you to come up with the money. He just asked you to say yes. Faith says yes. You got to be able to see yourself as the person God called you to be. And watch this. You cannot get caught up in your past failures. Because God is not worrying about it. Why are you worrying about it? But the devil, what he does, he tries to keep bringing up your past failures, because what the devil wants you to do is to get over into condemnation. And when you feel condemned, you run away from God. Like, I've used this example before. I'm going to use it again. Let's say, for example, we have women's meeting coming up, right? And so, Sister Florence, I use you. Women's meeting is coming up. And so the women are coming here, and Apostle Cynthia is coming. And we're all getting ready and all of that. And then one of your cousins calls you, right? That crazy cousin, because we all have one. Some families have two. And so this crazy cousin call you, and you almost don't answer the phone when you see it. You're like, but you answered it, right? And so before you know it, you know, you was about to leave the house, and before you know it, one thing led to another. You done went off on her. My God. And then you get off the phone, you feel like, how could I let her get me to that point? Oh, Jesus. I can't believe. Right? Not that happened to any of y'all. I'm talking about her. I'm talking about Florence. Because y'all holy, right? So you done went off on her. Now, what the devil does, he says, now you can't go to women's meeting. Because if you go to women's meeting, Pastor Cynthia is going to ask you to pray. And you can't pray. You ain't no condition to pray. You're not worthy to pray. Can I help you out? You weren't worthy before the phone call. You got to get to the point where it's not about me at all. Lord, I'm sorry. You know I should not have done that. I can't stand that girl. My God, I need you to help me. But I'm going to pray because I'm the righteousness of God in Christ. And when the devil says you ain't worthy, you say, I know it. He uses me anyway. My God. Hey! I know I'm not worthy. And God uses me anyway. The closer you get to God, the less you think of yourself. It's not even about you. Let me help you out. If you ever met somebody, not here, because you know, but you know, but you ever met somebody that just look at who's born again, so holy, their stuff don't stink, and they look down on everybody. Talking about everybody, look down on everybody, telling everybody they're going to hell, just looking down on everybody. That person is exposing to you that they're a baby Christian. Because there's no way you can know God and think you all that. The closer you get to God, the less you think of yourself. So when you see somebody that's going through, you say, my God, let me intercede for them, because if I think I'm saved, if I believe I'm saved with all the mess I done, I know they say, Father, have mercy on them and bless them. There's no way you're going to be close to God and look down on people. That's not who God is. You're going to be able to look at them and perceive them in the spirit and intercede for them. Say amen to that.
Amen.
You got to be able to honor yourself. You got to be able to see yourself in the spirit. You got to be able to accept it no matter how big it is. Because when God shows you things, especially about his plans for your life, they're so big that you're like, oh my God, why would you do that through me? Because he loves you.
Amen.
Say, God wants to bless me.
Not because I'm so good,
but because he's so good. You know why God wants to bless you? Because he wants to bless you. It has nothing to do with you. It's because he's good. And he made plans for you from the foundations of the world. And you got to get to that point. So you got to be able to see others in the spirit. You got to be able to see yourself in the spirit. And then finally, you got to be able to see your assignment in the spirit. You got to be able to perceive your divine assignment in the spirit. You must be able to see it. Let's go to Deuteronomy. Well, you don't have to turn there because it's just one little line here. But you can go to Exodus 3. Let's go to Exodus 3, and I'm going to quote Deuteronomy 1 and 8. So you got to be able to receive your divine assignment in the spirit. You got to be able to see who God called you to be in the spirit. Say amen to that. So Deuteronomy 1 and 8, and then we're going to go to Exodus chapter 3. So in Deuteronomy 1 and 8, now when it was time for the Israelites to go into the land promised to them, promised to their forefathers to give them, this is the land God promised Abraham some 400 years earlier, and said, this is the land, listen, I've given you this land. Matter of fact, I didn't tell you to turn there to Genesis, but even that was about seeing. He says, Abraham, listen, as far as you can see, I've given you the land. He says, how much land, Father? All you can see. What can I have, Daddy? All you can see. What's mine, Daddy? All you can see. If you can't see it, you can't have it. But if you can see it, it's yours. All you can see, I've already given it to you. He says, how much, Daddy? All you can see. Israel is millions of acres. He was able to see millions of acres. He was able to see it. All you can see, I've given it to you. Now, let's fast forward some 400 years. So now we know the story. God manifests himself to this man, Moses, at the burning bush. And we're going to look at Exodus chapter 3 in a minute. But Moses thought he had disqualified himself from his life's assignment because he did something wrong. Let me help you out. You can't disqualify yourself from something you never qualified for in the first place. He thought he had disqualified. He killed somebody, so he's out there in the wilderness. Man, I done wrecked my life. I grew up knowing that I had something special in me for the Israelites, but I done wrecked my life. Let me help you out. You didn't wreck your life. This is for somebody. Stop thinking. The devil got you thinking that you messed up because you were called. This is for somebody. When you were a child, things were prophesied over you in church. You come from a family of ministry, and things were prophesied over you in church from your own family members. Several things were prophesied over you, and you grew up knowing that. However, you got to a point where I see this in your late teens and your early 20s. You got to a point where you made some things and made some decisions on your own, and you feel like now the devil's told you that you've disqualified yourself. Let me help you out. The giftings and the callings of God are without repentance. That's King James. What does that mean? That means God doesn't change his mind, baby. Those plans are still waiting on you. And God, you know who you are, and God is revealing. Matter of fact, when we come to pray later, whoever you are, you come up here for prayer. So Deuteronomy 1 and 8, this is what, being able to see your divine assignment. So he says this, now it's time for them to take the land. So the Lord says to this man who he redeemed to be a redeemer, right? So he redeemed Moses to become a redeemer of the nation of Israel, and he says, listen, I want you to go. But when it's time to go into the land, he said this, Moses, see, I have given you the land. See, I have given you the land. The land is already yours. I have given it to you. Past tense. I have already given it to you, but you got to be able to see it. If you can't see it, you can't have it. But if you can see it, you can have it. See, I've given you the land. Now, let me back up, because what happened was they started tripping off the giants in the land, right? You remember the story, right? In Numbers chapter 13, 14, they started tripping off the giants in the land. I don't know why they were tripping. Let's go to Exodus chapter 3. You should be there already, right? I'm going to pick it up at verse 7. Verse 7, the Lord says to Moses, I have seen the troubles of my people, the troubles that my people have suffered in Egypt, and I've heard their cries when the Egyptians hurt them. I know about their pain. Now, I will go down and save my people from the Egyptians. Who's going to save them? God said, this is what I'm going to do, right? I will, number one, save my people from the Egyptians. Then he says, here's number two, I will take them from the land and then lead them to a good land where they can be free from all their troubles, right? So how many things is that? I got my fingers up. It's an open book test. two, right? So he says, so God says, I'm going to do two things, right? Stop playing. I'm going to do two things. I will lead them out of Egypt. I will lead them into a land that's flowing with milk and honey. And I already promised them this land. This is already theirs. I promised it to their forefathers to give them. And it's a land filled with many good things. Many different people live in the land, though. The Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Perizzites, the Hivites, the Jebusites. So God already told Moses that the land was inhabited. He already told Moses the people were there. I don't know why they was tripping later, right? I mean, you know what I'm saying? He already told them the people were there. God will reveal something to you today to prepare you for success tomorrow. God will reveal things to you. God, that's why we have an advantage. Why? Because we can hear from God. See, in the Old Testament, they had one tribe of priests and 11 tribes of kings, right? And so there's this revelation. If you read Revelations 1, verses 5 and 6, there's this teaching that we can do called the revelation of priests and kings. And so, but in the Old Testament, there was one tribe of priests and 11 tribes of kings. And what happened is that the 11 tribes of kings would come to the one tribe of priests. And they would come to the tribe of priests. Why? To hear from God. And the Levites were the only ones that really were the intercessors between God and man. And so they heard from God. So the one tribe of priests didn't go fight. They spent time hearing from God. So their assignment was to hear from God and then tell the people what God said. Why? So that they would have revelation. And once they had revelation, they had an advantage. They had an advantage over their enemies, and that they were supposed to go out and do battle. And since they had revelation from God, they're supposed to win. And then they're supposed to come back and bring home the spoils. And that they were supposed to give a tenth to the Levites for giving them the word. You know what I'm saying? Good looking out, baby. And then, you know, come speak to me again. And they would hear from God, get a revelation. Now, we're born again. We don't need to go through all that. We are prophet, priest, and king ourselves. So now I can hear from God myself, get a revelation myself, and then go out on Monday morning and do battle. And I'm supposed to come back here and bring home the spoils and release the tithe and the offering and get a word from God and go back out on Monday morning and do battle and win because I got a revelation. And the revelation gives me an advantage. So they had an advantage. They heard from God. He says, the land is yours, but they could not see it. 10 out of the 12 spies said, we are not able. 2 out of the 12 spies says, we are well able. But see, the millions of people believed the 10 instead of the 2, and millions of people died in the wilderness because they were not able to see. Say, I must be able to see it. Say, I must be able to see it. Here's the point. The point is that God has already made plans for you from the foundations of the world. And what God is doing on a daily basis is attempting to reveal those plans to you. He is showing you not what he wants to give you, what he already gave you, what is already yours. But you must have the ability to see. As I start to wind this down, let me say this, because the Lord just, he said it earlier this morning. He reminded me just now. While I've been preaching, I got one more scripture to deal with, but while I've been preaching, the Lord has been revealing, and this is not one, this is many, many of you. While I've been preaching, the Lord has been revealing things to you. Because now, because I'm teaching on this, there's an anointing present for it. And so you've been able to see things that are future to you but past to him. In heaven, it's already done. For us, it's just a matter of time. And so God has been revealing things to you that are future to you but that are already done for him. If that's you, I'm not talking about yesterday. I'm not talking about this morning. I'm talking about right now while I've been preaching. If the Lord has been revealing things to you about you, raise your hand. Amen. All right, praise God. Now put your hand down. Now, the reason why he wanted me to say this, the reason why he was showing you these things is because he needs you to stir back up your faith. There was a time where those things were at the forefront of your faith, and those things were lying dormant, and today he brought them back up. Why? Why did he bring them back up? Because it's just a matter of time. I hear that those things that he revealed are imminent. That's what I hear. All right? Okay, last scripture, 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 18. 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 18. Last scripture, we'll close out with this. The Apostle Paul said, this is what I'm talking about today, right? You got to be able to see in the spirit. The Apostle Paul said this. We focus our eyes on what we cannot see, not what we can see. We are focusing our eyes, our spiritual eyes, though, not natural eyes, not on what we can see in the natural. We are focusing our eyes all the time, spiritual eyes, on what we see in the spirit. He says, what we see in the natural only lasts for a short time, but what we see in the spirit lasts forever. It's permanent. And I'm going to say this by permission, because when the Lord told me, I want to make sure nobody gets offended. If you get offended, pray about it, because the Lord released me to say this. I just want to, by way of illustration, watch this. He's saying, we spend our times looking at things that we can't see with these natural eyes. We're supposed to spend our time looking at what we can see in the spirit. Watch this. Minister Percy, who does not have natural sight, can see more than most people in this room. Because he can see in the spirit. You must be able to see it. If you can't see it, you can't have it. Faith is not you coming up with something and trying to get God to put a yes on your plans. Faith is what God came up with. And faith is God trying to get you to put a yes on his plans. Faith is not you convincing God. Faith is you being convinced of God. Faith is what happens when you get to the point where you know that you saw it. And once you know that you saw it, if that reality becomes more real to you than what you see down here, then you won't be moved. While we were driving around Elder Georgia and looking at land, and I wasn't moved. You know, I was like, well, no, this ain't it. Go to another one. This ain't it. Go to another one. This ain't it. Okay, cool. I'm not saying if the Lord shows me where to go, he will. Cool. But until then, we'll keep looking. You know why? Because faith requires action. Faith requires me going out to launch. Faith is not me sitting at my house saying, well, the Lord told me I got a job. Job, come to me. No. Faith is me. I got to go do something. Say this. Say faith is something I say. Say faith is something I do. Say faith is something I sow. Is a word I say, is an action I perform, is a seed I sow. I got to do something if it's faith. But it's an action that I'm performing based on what I saw in another reality, based on what I saw in another realm. And I'm not moved by what I'm seeing down here in this realm. We went land after land. This ain't it. This ain't it. This ain't it. Okay, I told my wife, well, this ain't it. We didn't see it this time. We'll be back in July. We'll be back in 6 weeks. We'll look again. I'm not moved by it. And what this is what we can't do. This is where Abraham messed up. What we can't do is say, well, it's taking too long. Let me just go ahead. This is good enough. It might be good, but it ain't God. God didn't call us to just do that. And then we mess around and get an Ishmael instead of an Isaac. This whole thing between the Jews and the Muslims, that started with two women in a tent in the desert. And it ain't going to get fixed till Jesus come back. You know what I'm saying? I mean, so you don't want to mess around. Get out there ahead of God. Faith is not you trying to get out there ahead of God. It's going to happen in God's timing. You cannot be moved. You got it, the right thing at the wrong time is the wrong thing. You got to be comfortable. You got to be comfortable with a certain level of discomfort. You got to be comfortable with a certain level of mystery. Well, how come God hasn't done? How come God has healed a lot of people here? How come God hasn't healed Minister Percy's eyes yet? Well, I don't know, but you know what? God is using him mightily, and if he does, he does. But at the end of the day, there's a certain level of mystery to walking with God. We don't have all the answers. If we had all the answers, then if I had all the answers, then I would be God's God. But who am I? My God. So we got to learn how to be okay with a certain level of mystery. We got to learn how to be okay with a certain level of discomfort. You can't get too comfortable with God. I mean, listen, we're about to move into this building. And if you think you're comfortable now, then get ready to be uncomfortable. Because God has called us. It's bigger than you. It's not about you. It's not about you, but it's about what he called you to do. Here's the bottom line, though. You must be able to see it. If you can't see it, you can't have it. Let's stand up and give God some praise all over the building. Thank you, Jesus. That would have been okay if it was for me. Let's give God some praise, though, for what he said. Hallelujah. Come on now. Thank you, Jesus. All right, we'll do this first. We're going to speak something over our own lives. And as you're saying it, yes, Lord, the Lord is going to be revealing things to you. And so as you're saying it, you'll be seeing it. As you're saying it, you'll be seeing it. And so as you're saying it, you'll be seeing it. You need to start rejoicing. Amen? Say this. Say, Father, I thank you for giving me your spirit. Your spirit lives in me. He gives me the ability to see. I have your spirit so I can know what you're thinking on a daily basis. I have your spirit so I can know the plans you made for me from the foundations of the world. Now you speak to me on a daily basis and throughout the day. You speak to me spirit to spirit. You reveal things to me about my future. They are future to me. They're already done for you. For you is already done. And for me, it's just a matter of time. So I thank you, Father, for the ability to see. I live my life off of what I see in the spirit. I see now, and I'm not moved by what I see in the natural. In Jesus' name, amen. Give God some praise for that. Thank you, Lord. This is the beginning.